Circuitscape is a piece of software that is used by academics, by government organizations, by public policy folks, by students, by universities, by all kinds of people across the world to basically find wildlife corridors. It helps wildlife conservation, and the basic principle behind it goes as follows: that if you have a bunch of national parks, I mean, all of us visit national parks, tiger reserves, and whatnot. And you know, the generally people think that, okay, if we create this patch of land and, you know, we protect it really well, then, you know, all good things are going to happen and we'll protect our flora and fauna and all the other good stuff. But it turns out that that's not enough. It turns out, as ecologists would tell you, or like they told me, I mean, I didn't know any of this stuff myself, it's not just important to have protected pieces of land, but it's important that all these protected pieces of land be connected. If you have a shortage of food in one place, the animals need to migrate to the next one. You need genetic diversity, so you need animals from different national parks to sort of mix up. You may have disease that might take out one population, so migration becomes essential. It is an essential part of all ecology and all conservation efforts. And as all of you guys probably already know, we live in a world where, you know, sort of development and conservation are always at loggerheads. People are trying to urbanize, you know, villages are disappearing, fields are disappearing, forests are disappearing. And on the other hand, if you need to conserve, then you need to set land aside, you need to do all this other good stuff. And how do you go about doing that? And that's what this talk is about. I'm not going to talk too much about data, software, computation. I'm going to touch about a little bit of it. But what I hope you guys will take away from this is how a domain-specific problem is solved using using computation. So this is exactly what Circuitscape is. It is a free open source software package. Actually, it's licensed under it used to be licensed under the LGPL, but it's now licensed under the Creative Commons. Package that borrows algorithms from electronic circuit theory. So that's the word why circuit in it, to predict connectivity in heterogeneous landscapes. So circuit theory and landscapes, hence the name Circuitscape. And that's our logo out there. It's a resistor that kind of looks like mountains, and there's a mountain lion on top of it, actually, which was one of the first applications of Circuitscape. So like I already talked about, the problem that we're trying to solve is that of connectivity and gene flow. And it has been solved for all these animals, you know, wolverines, mahogany. It actually applies to trees also, right? Because you have dispersion of seeds and you have genetic material flowing across landscapes for trees. So pumas, sage grouse is that weird looking bird out there. I don't think it can fly. That's a wood frog out there on the upper right hand corner. And many more species. And this is just a small list, actually. If you go on Google Scholar and you search for Circuitscape, you get 280 results. So that what that says is that there are 280 scholarly publications where someone has actually done work using Circuitscape to figure out all kinds of stuff. And I mean, there are all kinds of lizards and frogs and rats and tigers and you know, things that I've never heard of that people are using Circuitscape for. And that's really, it's really fun to see, you know, when you write a piece of software that people actually put it to use in ways that you never imagined. Just last year, we got this certificate of accomplishment that by the special group, the Special Ecology and Telemetry Working Group of the Wildlife Society. They just decided that this was an important piece of work for their domain, and they ended up giving us this award. So that's kind of nice. Oh, thank you. This is a cover of a journal, Methods in Ecology and Evolution. That picture that you see out there is actually, I mean, you know, it looks actually like a satellite image of some mountains or something, but it's actually a current flow on a landscape as computed by Circuitscape. So I guess we also have enough artistic stuff that, you know, we can be on covers of journals now. Okay, so with that small introduction, What do we really do with Circuitscape? So it goes back to the basics. I think everyone here is probably an engineer. Not everyone, but maybe I should say whoever's not an engineer should maybe raise their hand. There's like three people. Oh, five people. Okay. So So I think all of us maybe remember going to in our first year learning something about Ohm's laws and about physics and current and voltage and all those things. And here's the kind of circuits I'm pretty sure all of us remember solving, right? If you put 1 ampere of current at point A and at B is grounded, how does current flow through all these resistors? And it turns out that, you know, when you have a parallel circuit like that, it will split off assuming the resistors are the same. So one becomes 0.5 and 0.5, and then it kind of connects up. You get another 1 ampere in the middle red bit, and then the same thing happens again. So that's, you know, that's your basic, you know, if you apply your Ohm's law and your parallel resistors and your serial resistors and work through all that stuff, you get that. And all of us kind of toiled over it in our entrance exams and whatnot. At the bottom is an example. I think it's cutting over my slides, but okay, I think it'll work fine. At the bottom is an example where you have A and B. So they are not points. They're actually, you know, you can think of them as metal bars or landscapes, since we are talking about ecology. And you have the white path, which is pretty broad, and then you have a pinch point. So if you have a pinch point, what happens? And it's exactly what we saw in that example above, right? All the current that was flowing nicely and smoothly through the, through that wide part, now has to go through the pinch point. So it all kind of comes in and sort of goes through the pinch point, and then again comes back out. That pinch point is your problem, right? If that pinch point goes away, if it takes very, you know, it's not easy to cut up that large piece of, the large piece of land out there. But if you cut off that pinch point by, let's say, building a highway, those animals from point A are never going to make it to point B. Now, why do we need to think about this as current? Hold on. I mean, you know, someone might say, oh, why don't we just think of this as a graph and find the edges that you could remove from the graph and find which parts of the graph remain connected. Yes, that was one of the first things that people did, and turns out it works well for some things and it doesn't work well for many things. So here's a similar example, but with slightly different paths. So think of the white areas as your reserve. So that's your, you know, Kanha National Forest or your Jim Corbett National Park. Think of the two that you like and picture them there. And if you like to think of some foreign ones, you can think of those too. The purple part is the habitat. The white is the reserve. So the reserves are where animals can live, prosper, find food, all the good stuff, find mates and all that. The black parts are probably cities, I mean, or habitation or stuff where people live, where animals don't like to go. So if you applied graph theory to a problem like this, it's just going to take the shortest path. But in reality, that's not what happens. You know, a lot of animals will go over the wider area, but there will always be some stragglers kind of going through, you know, through the smaller paths, right? I mean, that's what you'd intuitively think. So if you model this landscape or all these cells, this grid, as a series of resistors, so just think every cell is connected to all its neighbors with a resistor, and you can assign values to that resistor in a way that have meaning to you. You can then compute the current flow, and that's exactly what happens. Most of the current goes through that upper nice part, the heavy part, and there's a little bit of current that goes there. So it kind of maps your intuition about how you would see movement on such a landscape. Okay, so a more realistic landscape. All these white pieces are your reserves, and all the other stuff is not uniformly good or bad, but the darker it is, the less likely you can go through. And the black pieces, they are just, I mean, you can't go through the black pieces at all. So think of the black piece as, you know, if it was a panther, think of the black piece as maybe a large tract of water or a highway or something. So how many of you guys, actually maybe a show of hands, how many of you guys have noticed wildlife crossings on highways? So almost everyone, right? They're underpasses. I've actually been in places where I've seen overpasses where they build a bridge for the animals to cross over. And how do you think these underpasses are made? Do you think when the guy building the road is, you know, he sees a deer and he's like, oh, I should just cut a piece of underpass out here? that's actually how it usually be, happens. Or maybe some official from the forest department will decide that this is where animals should cross, and if not here, nowhere else. Sometimes they're guided by their intuition and it turns out to be right. But it's nice to have some more systematic way of doing these things. And stuff like Circuitscape comes to the rescue. So as we go into this landscape, those are the two points of interest. Let's imagine those are the two areas that we want to protect. And here's a least cost path solution. So we are looking at all possible least cost paths that go from across those two reserves. And as you can see, the black stuff is, you can't go through that, so you have to go around it. But there's a second path also. Can everyone kind of see the second path to go from across, the diagonal here? There's one that you can go right at the bottom. But typical graph analysis will not pick up that because that's a long winded route. If you run Circuitscape, this is what you end up getting. And you see all those pinch points, right? So wherever the paths are narrow is where all the current ends up getting focused and you get high current flow there. So this is what circuit theory gives us. So again, just putting both these pictures side by side, just trying to build the intuition here. So there's some value in doing the least cost stuff, and there's some value in doing the circuit analysis. And in practice, actually users combine all these methods. They don't just use one tool. I mean, there's not one single thing that always works. People actually end up using a bunch of tools to guide their intuition and to make decisions. Why does this become important is, if you have to connect those two areas and you have all this other, let's say human settlements or highways or all sorts of other stuff that you need to overcome. Let's say you're an agency that funds, purchases of land for conservation purposes. Where should you purchase? I mean, if you have to go through a city, do you just pay lots and lots of money to buy urban land? Or maybe there are alternative, not so good approaches, but are monetarily more feasible, getting the most out of your conservation dollars. So those are the kinds of questions that we can begin to answer once we kind of move beyond just thinking of least cost paths on graphs. I mean, as we broaden our horizons about thinking about the problem. And so that's exactly here now. So here now we've combined we have a hybrid approach, and the hybrid approach identifies all those pinch points which you need to safeguard in order to, in order to put your conservation dollars at work for this artificial problem. So we started with a toy problem, we looked at resistors, we looked at a simple case, then we went to an artificial landscape, and now we move on to a real landscape. This is, you might recognize, that's Alaska right up there, and I'm no ecologist, so I don't know why the gray portion is of importance, but apparently that's the area of interest in this case. And here are various things that happen. If your mental model is that animals move along the shortest path, geographical distance, right, just as the crow flies, you get A. If you think it's the least cost path, if you do your graph analysis, you would get B. If you model with circuit theory, you get the picture C. So the same Wolverine data, the same genetic data that's put, so what happens is that they sample genetic data at all across this landscape, and you can correlate, this animal at point A versus that animal at point B, what's the genetic difference between them? And you can then try and correlate how well that works with your model. Does your model predict the similarity of gene flow across those two regions? It turns out that if you use geographical distance, you get an R-square of 0.24, which is pretty bad. You want an R-square close to 1.0. If you go with least cost paths, you get an R-square of 0.37. And with circuit theory, you get 0.68. And we often see much higher R-squares in other applications. So, just like anything else, this is a model, it's not perfect, it's not accurate, but it's better than many of the other things that people did before. So from Alaska, we actually moved to India. If you see on that map of India, all those green colored regions, there are lots and lots of protected areas or forests. Actually spanning all the way from Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka. I think many of you might actually recognize what these places are. And this picture that's actually blown up, it's central India blown up and with Circuitscape running through all these landscapes. So you can, these landscapes are like right here, all of these little pieces all over the place. And this team of scientists whose names are up there, they wrote this paper, all of them. So they actually sampled genetic material across all these national parks. And they found out that actually it's not just that genes are propagating across the entire swath of central India. They actually found that the same tiger has physically moved from Madhya Pradesh to Karnataka. And you know, that's important in how we think about conservation, right? Because if your model of conservation is treat this landscape as a jail, put a big fence around it and don't let anyone do bad things inside, turns out that's not sufficient because the animals need to get out as well. And it turns out they do. Leopards get out, tigers get out, and they actually roam across large parts of these landscapes. But you know, as they conclude in their paper, I mean, you can look for this exact paper. You can put it in Google and it'll show up. But they basically say that our results suggest that such unplanned development will greatly compromise landscape level connectivity for tiger populations in central India. They say, they find out that tiger populations are stable, they are good, they are healthy. But unless we actually start thinking about conservation in a more systematic way, which is what tools like Circuitscape actually make it possible for, we will start seeing some of the bad effects. Again, I might be dramatizing this a little more than maybe they would do in the paper, but that's my job as a speaker. Okay. So now that we've seen, all these various different problems, how do we do it? So Circuitscape is currently at 4.0. It was, it has been rewritten thrice over 10 years. Yeah, I'm assuming people can guess what those logos are. So maybe, just since we're after lunch session, maybe get some interaction going with the audience. So the first one is Java. The second one is MATLAB, and the third one. So 1.0 was in Java actually, which was not written by me. The MATLAB version was written by me, and then the Python version was written by the three of us, who are the authors of this paper. But this journey is not over. I mean, I thought 5 years ago when we started our work to convert it to Python that our work would be over. That, we have reached the holy grail, no more. It turns out, the users want higher performance, they want to solve bigger problems, and we are unable to do it in Python. And of course, I have a, my interest is always to do stuff in Julia, and I think we are getting there. So maybe sometime this year or next year, we may actually end up rewriting all of Circuitscape in Julia or some parts of it anyway. We use a number of Python libraries. Many of you who are actually working with data out here doing machine learning might have actually used many of these. We use NumPy for all our basic matrix operations. But NumPy doesn't give you everything, it only gives you dense matrix operations. So we use SciPy to do sparse matrix operations and graph operations and solving linear systems. It turns out that the basic stuff in SciPy is not good enough to solve our problem. So we actually go to this library called PyAMG, which is from a few guys over in the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. They wrote this library to largely do graphics related work, but turns out one of its largest applications is in Circuitscape for this application. We have the GUI in WXPython and Python card. Python card is unfortunately an unmaintained piece of software, so that's giving us quite a lot of grief, but we are stuck to it. We are just hoping that it continues to work. We use the multiprocessing package in Python, not the package, I guess, the multiprocessing module in Python for all our parallelization. So all our parallelization is actually done using fork, which means it doesn't work on Windows as of now, which is quite a commonly used platform for Circuitscape. But if you are on a Mac or Linux, we actually can fork off a number of processes which will use the same memory and give you parallel speed up. It would be nice to have multi-threading. We don't have it in Python, the way one would like it. So this is the next best. And then there's plugins for ArcGIS and QGIS, which is where users can actually use Circuitscape through an environment that they are used to working with. So all your landscape data, all your satellite imagery and everything will come into one of these GIS software. this is what the GUI looks like, pretty basic and rudimentary, nothing like all the fancy pictures I just showed you. Those pictures are actually post-processing, they don't come out of the software because there's a fair amount of interpretation of the data that happens to get the right pictures. But this is the basic GUI. It basically encapsulates all the options that one might want to use Circuitscape with. But what this doesn't do is it doesn't show the fact that Circuitscape actually is a real Python package. You can just, it has an API, you can just integrate it into any other Python software. And the moment we did that, you know, more and more people have started using it. It has this big white window where all the ugly logs come out, giving you more information than you probably care about. Just like most other pieces of, it's open source, right? It doesn't need to be, you know, fully pretty and nice. I mean, it can have some under the hood stuff, right? So that's useful for us when someone wants to send us a bug report, and bugs are, you know, often reported because people, you know, what people often do with software such as this is they think it's black box. You have an ecologist who has very little training in computer science or mathematics or anything else. I mean, they're trained as ecologists. And here they're trying to use this piece of software, and the, you know, imagine the software telling you your matrix is ill-conditioned, and the guy just goes like, huh? You know, and what do you do at that point? I guess here you do what it says at the bottom. Please send feedback to the Circuitscape user group. We wish there were better ways to handle all these things, but, you know, it's such is life, I guess. Okay, so the data that it consumes is typically satellite imagery, typically a raster grid. The smallest problems, I showed you guys a grid earlier, so 100,000 cells is the most commonly used size of problem, I would say, if you're, you know, doing a small problem, like a homework problem in the university or something. A real use case is people will work with 1 million cells, trying to push towards 10 million cells, and, you know, they really want 100 million cells, I think we'll get there. But if you want to do full Earth scale simulations, you need to go to a billion cells. And a billion cells is, all of this stuff, by the way, happens in memory. We cannot leverage Hadoop, we cannot leverage out of core, we cannot leverage distributed computing. Maybe we can if I spend a year of my time writing solvers for this, and even then it may not. So, you know, if there's some mathematicians in this audience who understand multi-grid methods, you know, please contact me. I'm sure we can collaborate. But at this stage, it's pretty tough. But again, I hope we'll get there. The finer the resolution, the larger the grid. So if you want to model a tiger, you know, tiger, I mean, the way the modeling works is how the animal perceives the environment around it and decides to sort of move in a particular direction. If you see a water body, you may not want to go there. If you see vegetation or forest cover, you might want to go there. If a tiger sees a city, it may try to avoid it, or lights at night. Of course, that's completely different from what a frog would see. I mean, the frog needs to work at much smaller scales, and so what a tiger might use for modeling a tiger, you may need 100-meter resolution, let's say, might be good enough. For a frog, you may need to do 100 centimeters. I mean, I don't know, but it's easy to imagine that it's a factor of 10 at least. Okay, so that's the data, and the data sets can be pretty large. The computation is, of course, the real bottleneck here. So what happens here, I'm going to quickly run through this. This is not, I'm not going to teach you all everything that Circuitscape does. I don't think that's even possible. But if you're interested, please come and talk to me. We load the data, we process the raster landscape, we create a graph out of it. We compute connected components of the graph because, you know, for those of you guys who do linear algebra or machine learning, you might remember that if your matrices are not completely connected components, you get, you know, it'll end up being singular, and which means you can't solve it. Which translates to animals in the animal space as if you have two landscapes and no path to go from one to the other, the resistance is infinity. So, you know, the math problem maps to the actual physical problem with this language. Once we get the connected components, that means, you know, every point in that piece of landscape is connected to every other. So you can actually, you know, physically go from one to the other. Once we get those components, we create a sparse matrix in SciPy. We set up and solve the linear system. It's essentially solving Ohm's law. Do people recognize this form of Ohm's law, by the way? yeah, a lot of people do. A lot of you might think of it as V equals I times R, right? Voltage equals current times resistance. G is just conductance out here. So I've, you know, it's the other way around. So we have conductance times voltage equals current. And, you know, what we used to solve on hand and by paper is now just solved at much larger scale. So instead of 5 resistors, we are solving it, you know, for millions of resistors. And that turns out to be a linear system that you have to solve. The system is so big that traditional solvers cannot solve it, and hence we have to use specialized solvers to actually solve these things. And after that, we compute voltages on every branch, get currents on every branch, and then you get the pictures that you saw. And a million grid is now a few hours. When Brad and I started our collaboration, I mean, again, you know, this is how, you know, you get an ecologist and a computer science talking. When Brad actually first started solving this problem, he could solve 100 cells in hours. Today, we are at a point where we are doing millions of cells in minutes. So, you know, lot of computer science and math brought into solving the problem. Of course, users are never happy. You know, they don't want 100 meter resolution. They want 100 centimeter or 1 centimeter. And sometimes, you have a discussion saying, hey, that doesn't make sense. You know, that's artificially small and, you know, people just want to run it. What do you know? So the largest machine I've seen people using is 80 cores and a terabyte of RAM. Did you guys know you can actually buy these things today? Turns out now you can buy 2 terabyte RAM machines, and Circuitscape users would love to get their hands on them if they can afford them. Okay, so that was all the compute behind it, and I'm going to go to one last application here. And this is the entire North, and I guess on this thing it doesn't look very nice, but this is the North and the South Americas, and this is modeling modeling rain shifts under climate change. So climate's changing, you know, it's a fact. I think all of us believe it by now, contrary to what politicians often want us to believe. And when climates change, animals have to move, species have to move in large distances to actually, sort of survive. And when they have to move, you know, Circuitscape comes can be used to figure out how they're going to move. And what's likely to be a problem when you have such large scale movement? It's you run into barriers like humans, right? I mean, you run into cities, you run into bridges, you run into all kinds of other stuff there. You run into urbanization, basically. And this is not this is an application where it's not that we have 2 pieces of land that we are trying to connect and protect, but it's a large scale migration that will happen over 100 years. And we need to make sure that, you know, we are ready for it if we care about these things. So this is a region of South America that's blown up, and it shows migration patterns that go through some of the, you know, some cities like Buenos Aires, for example, big red, red arrows looking ominous. So, you know, I'm assuming that's a good thing here. Similar thing in North America. This is a region that's again a densely populated region. This entire simulation actually was done for 2,903 species. So it's not just one species. It actually takes into account, you know, thousands of species and creates this map of movement out of that. And here's an example from the paper that was published by Lawler and other colleagues for the Waxy monkey leaf frog. I had not heard of it until I saw this paper. And that's the region, you know, that's the stable region right out there. And if it needs to expand because of climate change, that's what you're looking at as things warm up and contraction is thing on top. So this version actually shows the movement pattern. So the circuit currents have been computed. So you can see the directions of the arrows that show how these things are likely to move. And much of this, although the math and computer science is fully under, you know, something I fully understand, I don't fully understand the ecology. So I leave the science to the scientists here. Another one of these, this is for mountain lions, same story. This is across four states in the United States. And you can see how the Interstate 40 and the Interstate 10 out there are cutting right across important movement paths. So that's where you start thinking about where should those underpasses and the bridges and all the other good things need to be. Again, more pictures of the same here. And with that, I end my presentation and I'm open for questions. This one right in the front row.
So how do you quantify the resistance values? So it has to be from a lot of physical factors.
Absolutely.
Right? So how do you, is it just intuition or there is some science behind it?
There is, it's an art as well as a science, as you can imagine. So it you know, for example, like the tiger study that I talked about in India, they looked at luminosity patterns, you know, from satellites. So to figure out where you have habitation and work that into the resistance because they cared about urbanization. If you don't care about urbanization, you may leave that out. So your resistance actually ends up encapsulating a lot of domain knowledge.
And on a lighter note, can you use this software to model Bangalore traffic? Because a lot of traffic follows least resistance, right? And a lot of drivers are very primal.
I would think so. Why not? I've thought about it as I drive around. The one thing I should point out though at this stage is that it cannot model one way because current flows in both directions. So, whereas Bangalore traffic usually just flows in one direction. Hey, Shikant, yeah.
Hey, so, Viral, I was curious about whether this approach will work for water flows. Human habitation can obstruct water flows and cause flooding and other kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And would the circuit approach work for migration of water, movement of water?
For water, like for rivers, courses and stuff like that?
Or could, even when it rains?
Or groundwater?
Groundwater, yeah.
It's unlikely, I feel. I mean, again, I'm just kind of guessing here, but water flows are driven by gravity. And whereas current flows are, I would say, yeah, you can draw a parallel between gravity and voltages. Yes, I would think you should be able to get somewhere with water flows for sure. The key thing is, as long as whatever you're modeling doesn't go, can go both ways. It's not that it just goes one way. So, it has to look, I mean, if you want to use Circuitscape, if you want to use resistive networks, then those basic principles of how current moves have to hold. And if that holds, you can model anything. So, I should say, for example, that anthropologists have used that to map how human migration patterns happen, which was completely different kind of an application from the animal stuff that we do here. Maybe water's possible. Right, there's one in the center there. And
hey, just wanted to know, especially some of these stuff you're talking about in the Python and all that, the use of PySpark and could get you a lot of the distributed computing stuff into those things. Worth exploring.
Sorry, I couldn't. Could you speak a little louder? I can't hear you very well.
The PySpark might be really worth exploring.
PySpark.
PySpark. Spark has an excellent interface. You know, the Python interface and a lot of your Python code.
Okay.
Might, you know, one could explore that and worth get looking into because you get access to the Spark cluster, you know, for the distributed computation. So,
the algorithm
is this open source? And I mean, can we look at it and
I'm aware of Spark. I'm not fully convinced yet because the PyAMG solver that we use, that's a pretty complex piece of software. And it's unlikely to go and work in a distributed manner. I mean, you'll actually get slowdowns if you go distributed. Unless we have some mathematical innovations that we can put into work in distributed mode.
Oh, okay. 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 Thank
you. But maybe some mathematician can come and help me out. So to add to your point, basically when you take an algorithm like this that's inherently sequential or maybe at most multi-threaded, if you want to make it distributed, you actually need to rethink the problem and break it up in a way that it's amenable to distributed computation and it's a topic of active research, but active research has to translate to usable, robust software that users can use. So maybe in the future. Yeah.
So how did this whole project of Circuitscape start? Like, how do you get the idea that you can apply circuit theory to solve a problem like this?
So that was not my idea. That was actually my colleague's idea. He's an ecologist. That was his PhD thesis. He was an engineer, an electrical engineer who started studying ecology, and he put two fields together. And that's how the original thing started. But the software wasn't nearly as scalable as it needed to be. And that's how our collaboration started. So he came to me to ask for parallelization because it was too slow. It turned out we could do a lot more without parallelizing.
Been applied to domains other than ecology, like finance?
Sorry, where are you?
Yeah.
Okay, hi. Yeah.
Has this been applied to domains other than ecology, like finance?
Not finance, but like I said, in anthropology, people have tried it out. So that's the one that we know of. But you know, the software's out there. As long as you can convert anything to resistances
right.
on a landscape, you can solve on a grid, you can solve it.
Okay. And I don't know if it is applicable, but you seem to be working only on resistors, whereas circuit theory applies to inductance and capacitors, which is like complex numbers, right?
Right. Or even diodes.
Diodes, yeah, nonlinear elements.
So then you get into circuit simulation type stuff like SPICE, and the size of problem you can solve is dramatically smaller than what we are doing.
I agree. Yeah.
So in order to keep it mathematically feasible, computationally feasible rather, we have to stay with resistive.
Okay.
Elements. People do go with network flow based approaches. So that's the other, when you move away from just resistive networks, that's what one can look at. But those algorithms tend to be a lot more complex in terms of time running complexity.
So how hard it is to convince urban planners or city planners that a piece of software is better than what they think that they should do?
I think it happens slowly. It is happening slowly. For example, I do see routinely emails from people who are saying, you know, I'm a conservation planner in such and such a region, and I'm using Circuitscape for my analysis. So I think it's the usual scientific process. You know, the socialization process. I don't think it can be enforced from above, but it's training. It's, you know. Well, like I said, the Tiger paper was in India, and I do see people using it, but. It's India is usually behind on these things, and in India the conservation efforts are largely within government, where I think some of these things take longer time to get used. Am I done with should I 2 minutes? Okay.
Yeah. So this is an open source.
Yeah, it's open source.
Is it part of the university research, and how is the developers and what
is it model? It used to be it was part of my PhD, but since then me and my colleagues, every once in a while we'll get a grant from some conservation agency to revamp it to the next big version, but between those large periods there's a lot of work that's just maintenance, and we just do it out of passion. All right, thank you very much.